Let's talk about email. It seemed like a neat idea. First up, a little bit of the history of email. When it was first created, it was just an extension of FTP, the file transfer protocol. And really, exchanging emails was sending a file to someone else's computer. And now, obviously, it really hasn't changed all that much. You're still sending a small file to someone else's computer. But it's a little bit more intelligent in the way that you do that. So when it first came out, Ray Tomlinson had the idea to use that at symbol, what we now know as the at symbol, to separate the user from the host. So you would specify the user before the at, and then the host, the machine that you were communicating with, the sh machine that you wanted to send the message to, after the at symbol. And we still use that today. And so we use the username before the at, and the host now will use a domain name after the at symbol to indicate where we want to send that message. And I'm going to provide a link to I think it's the Today Show video that from the mid-90s that shows a little bit of misunderstanding of how that at symbol works and what it was. I thought it was pretty awesome. So inside the header of an email, we've got quite a bit of information. A lot of it you're familiar with. You see the date the email was sent, who the email is from, a subject and a destination, who the email is for. All of that information is stored inside of an email header. And that information is shared all along the path that the email travels to get to its destination. And it needs to be shared so that all along the path, everybody knows how to get the email to its final destination. Routing information is also stored inside the email header. So you can actually look inside of the email header and see which mail servers your email passed through to get to where it's going. And then finally, of course, the content of the email. That's pretty basic. So the Simple Mail Transfer Protocol, SMTP, is the protocol that email uses now rather than FTP as it was originally. SMTP is used to send email and it uses TCP port 25. And it actually uses another port as well for mail submission. So mail submission is the initial sending of the email. So when I send an email, I submit that email to my mail server. And that uses port 587 rather than port 25. It can also use port 25 to do that. Typically, it's not excluded. And then along the path, we use DNS MX records. And we'll talk in another video about DNS a little bit more extensively. But the MX records are the mail exchanger records that tell mail servers how to find other mail servers. So, for example, Gmail. You have separate records to go to gmail.com, the website, versus sending email to an address at gmail.com. And those records for sending email to gmail.com are those MX records that will be used. And again, that'll make more sense when we talk more about DNS. So, sending email, the whole process of sending an email. You've got your mail client on the sender's end that's going to be used to compose the email. And you might use Outlook, you might use Thunderbird, you might use Gmail's webmail to do that. And it doesn't matter which one you use. That part of the process is the same. You're going to compose an email and you're going to send it. And that goes to your, when you send it to that mail submission agent. And the mail submission agent, remember, is listening on port 587. Again, it might also be listening on port 25. And that is your SMTP server. That's how you're sending the email. And your mail submission agent is going to send the email to a mail transfer agent. And the mail transfer agent's job is to get mail where it needs to go. And whether that's directly to the final destination or just to another path, another step along the way, the mail transfer agent is going to be transferring that. It's in the name, to eventually the mail delivery agent. And the mail delivery agent is the receiver's mail server. So the receiver's mail server listens, receives that email on port 25. And then finally, on the ultimate receiving end, the destination, the recipient of the email, checks it with their own mail client. And they're going to connect with a different protocol to that mail delivery agent. And one of those protocols that they might connect with is the post office protocol. So SMTP is used to send email, and it's used only to send email. The post office protocol, POP3 is the current version, POP3, is used to check email. And it's one of the two major protocols used to check email. And that uses TCP port 110, 995 if it's encrypted. And it provides, basically, it's in the name, it's a lot like the post office. When you check your email, the server typically, by default, deletes the email. So once you check it, the server no longer has it. And when you download it, you download all parts of the email. So when you go to the post office, you can't check your little PO box and pull out only the front of your letters to see who the mail you're getting is coming from. You pull out all of the mail. And that's the same with the post office. So once you check your email with the post office protocol, you download those emails and they're deleted from the server, and you have them and you're now responsible for them. The server doesn't have anything. And that works fantastic as long as you have only one device checking email. It doesn't work so great when you have multiple devices checking email, because you might have an email, check it on one device, download all your emails on one device, they're deleted from the server and they're gone, and none of your other devices can have them. Now, nowadays, you can sometimes enable an option to leave emails on the server, even with POP. But for multiple devices, there's a better protocol, and that protocol is the Internet Message Access Protocol, IMAP 4. IMAP 4 is the current version. Another protocol for checking email uses TCP port 143, 993 if you're encrypted. And IMAP's focus, rather than downloading email and having it on one device, is synchronization. And IMAP allows you to synchronize your messages across multiple devices, including things like, have you read them? Have you replied to the email? Have you deleted the email? And all of that information is synchronized across all of your devices, rather than just focusing on one device like that POP protocol. So most of you today are most likely using IMAP or a version of IMAP to read your email or to check your email, because it's much better if you have multiple devices. If you have a desktop and a laptop, or a desktop at home and a desktop at the office, you're probably using IMAP on those devices to check those emails. And it also has the option to pull only parts of a message. So you can pull just the headers and see who you're receiving email from, who the destination is, if it's directly to you or if it's to a mailing list, and what the subjects of those emails are, without downloading the full email. Or you can download an email without downloading the attachments, and download the attachments only later when you want them. And IMAP really only gained popularity when storage space for email became cheaper. Initially, storing all of your emails on the server just wasn't feasible because there wasn't enough space, and space, storage space, hard disk space was expensive. And so allowing all of your customers or all of your employees to leave their email on your server just didn't work. But now that storage is relatively cheap, especially compared to what it was 10 or 15 or 20 years ago, it's much more common to use a protocol like IMAP to synchronize your email and leave those on the server. So there's other protocols that aren't as common, unless you're in an enterprise environment. MAPI is one of them, the Messaging Application Programming Interface. And this is a Microsoft proprietary protocol. And it has two versions, a simple version and an extended version. The simple version allows only some subset of functionality, and the extended version gives you everything. That's basically all I feel you need to know about that. And then a big one now is Exchange Active Sync. And this is big if you're using Exchange. And that means if your workplace provides an Exchange server, then you're going to be using Exchange Active Sync, most likely. You can also typically on Exchange servers configure POP or IMAP to send and receive your email that way. But ActiveSync is the protocol that Outlook uses, and it communicates instead of over SMTP or POP or IMAP, it communicates over HTTP, the web protocol. And this can be used to do all sorts of stuff. It synchronizes basically everything. Email, contacts, calendar, anything that Outlook gives you can be synchronized through this protocol. So that's pretty handy. It's great. The other protocols we've talked about are specifically and only for email. So they don't provide contact syncing or calendar syncing. You can't do any of that over POP or IMAP. And there are other protocols to handle that. But in Exchange, it's all handled through that Exchange ActiveSync. Now, I want to talk, before we're done here, I want to talk just a little bit about webmail. Webmail is probably the way that most of you are use email today, rather than using Outlook or Thunderbird or is there anything else left? Windows Mail, I guess, is an option built into Windows. Rather than doing that, most of you are probably using webmail. So, and this still uses those other protocols. It still uses SMTP and IMAP to send and receive email on the server side. It's only using HTTP or HTTPS to display your inbox to you on the client side, on your end. So it's a web-based mail client. Doesn't replace SMTP and IMAP. And that's why things get a little fuzzy when we talk about email not being a part of the web, because the email protocols, SMTP and IMAP and POP, are not a part of the web. But through things like webmail, through Gmail or Outlook Web Access, then your email and your view of email kind of does end up happening through the web. So this is just an awesome classic picture of Hotmail from, I don't know when, the mid 90s or early 2000s. Oh, it looks like it was early 2000s from the dates on those emails. But just a brief reminder of what Hotmail used to look like back when Hotmail provided 2 megabytes of storage for free, which was awesome. And then Gmail came out in 2006 and started giving a gigabyte, and everybody else had to catch up. So to wrap up, biggest things to know about email: it uses SMTP to send email, POP3 and IMAP to receive email and check those. And it's kind of important to know the differences between POP and IMAP. They're very different protocols, and they have very different ways of going about managing your email inbox. And that is email in a nutshell.